license to file. Go file. A lot of you got it on active sheets, you're just printing. That's not gonna work. So what I like to do first is I like to look at the margins. I go custom margins. You wanna click right here, center on the page, horizontal is vertical. Then when you go to your page, you wanna see fit to, right here. Then the settings to print, you wanna go print selection. So that gets in the middle of the page. Not multiple pages, but in the middle of the page, with equal spacing around. Does everybody understand how to do that? Do I need to go through that again? And then what I would do too, it looks like there's a thin line up here. I would go back and reformat this, right click, go down here to format cells, go to border, it's all there, okay, perfect. Everybody familiar with using number formatting? Separate things in the middle, set the fonts, border, you have to fill, you do fills, and then this will print. So what I would do is print them out as PDFs, and then print them out, or just print them out, so that you got the original portfolio, and you got the most recent updated price sheet, and then you got the 1 year, the 3 year, the 5 year, maybe the 10 year back testing sheets. And on front of that sheet, on front of this, a series of passive portfolios, you want to have them on. You're going to have to do them. Basically saying, you know, passive portfolio approach, expected returns, and performance. And then have the year-to-date performance against the S&P 500, the alpha, the 1 year, the 3 year, the 5 year return, S&P 500, the alpha, and the beta. Because that's all we really care about is the performance right against the benchmark. Quick portfolio, quick memo telling me about the performance of your, tell me a little bit about it, and then tell me the performance, how did you do it? Okay. So everybody knows how to print these things now? Okay. Has everybody gone back and can everybody print out these sheets? At least one, at least the leader, give me a printout of the sheets. Now, has everybody checked? Made sure that the 1 year, the 3 year, the 5 year is correct. It calculates the correct outputs, returns. Did you guys audit them to make sure? So I think for this one, you have to send to your leader with the spreadsheets, either print it out to him on a computer to my office so I can go over and check it and make sure it's correct.
Are you kidding me? I'm completely kidding. What do your front test?
Oh, there we go, Ivan.
Our back test.
I sent you another email. That's more updated.
Yeah, I got it. Because this one's actually working.
That's easy. Cake.
For some reason, I can't get it up.
I sent you another 30.
Oh, you did?
Stock price. Is it September?
Oh, did you just send it to me?
There should be one more.
Okay, while we're waiting, let's do the optimization. Let's go back. Now, is anybody having any problems putting the data into the worksheet? Have you started putting the data into the worksheet?
That's what I was gonna ask with the optimization.
We're gonna let's go through it step by step.
Where you put input stock data and you put arrows, that's where we put the three year back stuff.
This is the data. Let's do the first step first. Did you go to NASDAQ and pull up the data?
Yeah, the one film has yourself.
Did you start putting it in? Okay, I only see one person do it. I'm asking all of them. Did you go to NASDAQ and get the data, and then you started putting the data in?
For my old one.
Yeah, the old one. We know how to do it.
Okay, I'm just checking with everybody to see if they know how to do it. So is everybody doing it?
Yes.
Okay, so we already have the data. Did everybody get 5 years of data?
No.
Did you get 3 years of data?
Yes.
Did you adjust all of these? Okay, did you hear what I said?
No, we didn't adjust.
Did you get 5 years of data?
We will be.
No. Did you put 3 years of data? How many years of data do you have?
Some of them have one, some of them have
three. Okay, but you have to reset these.
I don't know how to do that.
I'm going to show you how to do it. Okay, so you're going to put the data in. You might want to take notes on this because there's a procedure to this. That's why this stuff is not easy. Okay, that's why they pay us analysts, you know, $150,000 to do this stuff because it's not easy. Okay, so you got to do it step by step. So I'm hearing that some people, how many people have 5 years of data? Got it. How many people have 3 years of data? Excellent. How many people have less than 3 years of data?
Watch how to do this.
Okay, now I'm getting, you told me you had less than 3 years of data.
Our new one that we're doing is five.
We just talked to you about giving a new one.
Okay, I'm just checking.
And most of these will have 5 years.
Okay, so it's just a different case, okay, scenario. So how many people have 3 years of data? Okay, so one group. You understand that you have to go back and...
Yeah, we got it.
Okay, perfect. And then everybody ran the descriptive statistics, and they basically match up. Okay, yes?
Okay.
Yes. Can you go through running that one more time?
Yeah. So you already know how to get it from NASDAQ.
Yeah.
Okay. Then once you copy and paste the data in here, you're gonna have to. If you have 5 years of data, it's already programmed. You don't have a problem. Boom, it's done. If you got 3 years of data, you got a problem because these means, medians, and standard deviations are calculated on a 5 year time period. So you're gonna have to go back. Here, and go all the way down until where the data Dakota, to where the data stops. Okay, so if it was a 3 year, because you only had 3 years of data, it's only going to give you 3 years of total returns. Okay, you're going to have to figure out, in this case, the very last cell is 1013. So what I got to do, I got to get back up here. This cell can change that.
To whatever the last cell was.
Whatever the last cell is, with data in it.
Well, this is on a 5 year.
This the 5 year is okay, but I'm saying the 3 year guy is going to go back.
Oh, so it'd be
and
like.
They got to adjust these so that it captures the 3 year, not the 5 year, because that it's going to get all messed up. The distribution is going to have a bunch of zeros.
Will you say it one more time just to make sure I have it right?
Yeah. Okay. The 5 year guys, you're okay. You're golden. Right? The 3 year guys, you got a problem. Okay? Because you got to go back here and figure out at what point there's no more data. Because this is capturing right now on 5 year. So I got 2 more years of data, right, in mind. You're missing 2 years. Right? So you're going to have to go back and set this cell right here. To where it ends for both the mean, the median, and the standard deviation. So it's capturing the data, not capturing all the zeros.
Got it.
Did everybody get that?
Yeah.
Okay. So you need to go back to your 25 stocks and reset the mean, median, and standard deviation. So it's capturing the 3 years, not the 5 years. Okay. Are you ready to go on to the next thing?
Yeah.
Okay. And then run the descriptive statistic and check. The numbers for validation. Okay, can we move on? Okay, got it. And then, the next thing you're going to do is I would go over and just make sure that your return series is correct.
And so does, when you're saying we have to run the descriptive statistics, is that if you have 5 years, does that not automatically compute?
Yeah, but what you're gonna do, what you're gonna have to do is when you run, let's say you have 3 years of data, you're gonna go data analysis, you're gonna go descriptive statistics, click on it, and you're gonna have to modify the range. Because this is capturing 5 years of data, not 3 years of data.
But if you have 5 years, then it's fine.
It all works.
Okay.
And I did send you the updated version, which is 1.1, which should have all of the solver in. Right, did everybody get that so far? Can we move on?
Yeah.
Okay, can we move on, you guys?
Yes.
We're just auditing the procedures.
Yeah.
So then, the next thing is I would go over and I would go take a look at my stock return data. And again, this data is a huge sample. It's very volatile. There's lots of extremes. Okay, so it's a really, it's a good, robust data set. Okay, because it's got 1,013 data points. I could have used quarterly, year over year, I could have used weekly, I decided to use daily, okay? That was just me, I just decided to do it. So here's your data series, your total returns, year over year, on a 365 data base. Got it. Then, you gotta go calculate the correlation covariance matrix. Is everybody clear on how to calculate the correlation and the covariance matrix? Yes? No? I got one no. Does everybody know how to calculate the correlation and the covariance matrices? I got one no.
Is that not just hit correlation? Yeah, just no. And then
okay.
Go through.
I'm still going to answer it. So now you got to calculate the correlation and the covariance matrix. So we'll do the correlation first. Go up to solver, go data analysis, go up to data analysis, click on correlation. Make sure you do the correlation in the correlation worksheet. All right? Make sure you don't make any mistakes. Click on OK. It's going to ask you what the input range is. Okay? It's already set up. Input range was the return range. Okay. The output range is this right here. Okay. It's all set up. Labels on the return worksheet is in the first row. Boom. The output range is this range right here. So that's all you gotta do is click on correlation, go to here. Theoretically, this box should already be there. If you're not getting it, then you gotta go back and redo it. So let me show you how to do it.
No.
It's not there. You didn't add in the data analysis in the solver pack in Excel. Do you want me to show you how to do this?
No.
Can you do this?
Yeah.
Dakota, can you do this?
Yeah.
Okay. Yes, sir.
My question was, you want us to put our data, these 25 stocks, into the optimization worksheet?
I've already, the only thing you have to do right off the bat, stick the data into the, right here.
Got it.
And then change the tickers so that they align with your portfolio in the order that you have in your spreadsheet.
Is it for his stuff?
So that's the first thing you do. Second thing you do is you go calculate because the return series is already done for you. So the only thing you have to do is to do the correlation matrix and the covariance matrix. I programmed the majority of the stuff. I didn't program procedures. Okay. So once that's done, then you go to the optimization, portfolio optimization page. Is everybody following? Now you go to the optimization page. Okay? And on the optimization page, if you did it right, your company's ticker will be here in order. That will align with the order down here. It will align with the table that has all the companies in it. Here's your company. The standard deviation is already calculated for you. The variance is already calculated, so it gives you an idea of the volatility of these stocks. As you can see, A and D is a really high standard deviation. So does P. I forgot what P was. Netflix is 85%, so you can see where the volatility is coming in. And it's usually going to be these companies that have had major problems, or they have just been, they're newly, new startup companies within the last 5 years. Okay, so they're still growing very rapidly. So their stock prices are highly volatile. Okay. Now you have the correlation here, and I did the correlation against Apple. Okay, you might have to put in an index. Or just pick up a large company within your index and use that as the correlation. Okay, that correlation really doesn't have any, doesn't do anything. It's just information. Okay. But the covariance is extremely important. Okay, this is the part you want to focus on right here. Okay, this is where people are having problems. Okay, what I've calculated here is the mean and the median return year over year on a daily basis. So these are the means of the 113 data points of returns. So this is the average annual return, mean and median, let's say for Apple, over the last 5 years. So Apple has returned on average every year for the last 5 years roughly 22 to 25%. So the question then becomes, what do you think the return is going to be for next year? For Apple. If Apple's been giving 22% rate of return every year for the next 5 years, what do you think it's going to be for 2018?
22%.
Okay. If you think it's not going to be 22% or slightly less, you put in 20. If you think it's going to be more than 22%, you put in 25. So the first thing I did was I checked, like IBM stock has been tanking over the last 5 years. So it's actually showing a mean and a median that's negative. I plugged in, I don't want to have any negatives in here, so I put in 3%. So I assumed that any stock in my portfolio is going to give me at least a 3% rate of return. Well, I plug in the minimum. Then I went back and I looked at Microsoft. Microsoft's been up around 22%. I don't think Microsoft's going to do 22% next year. So I took it down to 15%. So the first thing I do is I kind of eyeball these. And I go, what do I think the stocks are going to do next year just based off what I know about these companies? Okay, that's the start. Now you could create a cross-section regression model, arbitrage pricing theory, to be able to forecast the expected return for the stock. You could use a time series regression model and build in the factors and forecast what the rate of return is going to be for next year. You could use an exponential Holtz Winters smoothing model to be able to use past price trends, extrapolate it out for the next year to get what you think is going to be for 2018. You can conduct a securities analysis and project what you think the stock price is going to be for next year, figure out what the premium is going to be, stick it in there. To do this part of the cost would take a month to train you on how to do Holtz Winters, APT, time series, and I've already taught you how to do the intrinsic value. Probably going to be easier just to analyze the mean and median returns and figure out what you think the rates are going to be for 2018 and 2020. Probably save you a lot of time, unless you want to build the APT model, the time series model. I already taught you how to forecast the fundamental securities model. If you want to do that, you got to come see me, and I got to do a special training session for you.
If we wouldn't ever be going short on any of the stocks portfolio, then why would you keep something in here with a continuous negative return?
Because we've already conducted the fundamental securities analysis, and these are the stocks that we want in our portfolio.
Even though they're returning negative, and we're not going
to
go short.
Yeah, that's an opportunity for us to pick them up at a discount in our trading model. This is not a long-short portfolio, this is a long-portfolio.
Okay, that's what I was saying, it seems like...
The long-short portfolio is what we'll get into at the end of this semester.
Okay.
Okay, so this is a long-portfolio. So you put in your expected returns, boom, you got that.
All right.
Okay, is everybody clear on how to get the returns?
Okay.
Covariance matrix. So you know how to be able to highlight, can you highlight that table and print it out on a in portrait? Okay, where it looks good. Here's the covariance matrix. You want to be able to highlight this and print this out too. Okay. Because this is going to be in your appendix. Because I want to look at the covariance matrix. This is the report that you're getting. Right? So the report itself, you're going to have the cover page. You're going to have the appendix. You're going to have the outline, and then you're going to get into the report, and then you're going to have all the stuff that's going to be in the appendix. The report's only 5 pages, okay. So it's really short. So this is basically the heart of it right here. Yeah, we're getting now. The first thing you want to do is to calculate the minimum variance portfolio. Okay. Then we're going to go do the iterations. The second step is going through the iterations. The third set is doing the capital allocation line. Those are the three steps. First, calculate the minimum variance portfolio. Second step, run through the iterations to trace out the efficient frontier. Third step, calculate the capital allocation line. So there's three steps. Okay. So we have here, that's the 100% portfolio. All the weights always have to add up to 100%. You have the mean, expected return on the portfolio, you have the standard deviation, and you have the slope. Okay. Those are the three that we need. Now, you need to note, what I did here was I used expected returns. Historical expected returns. I didn't use the risk premium, okay, in this model. You need to qualify it. But these are expected returns that we use. Okay. And I think that intuitively, when you subtract out the risk-free rate to get the risk premium, the risk-free rate is a constant. Okay. So it really isn't going to have a material difference to the actual efficient frontier at the end of the day, because you're just subtracting by a constant. But to be theoretically correct, I would have used risk premiums, but I decided just to use total returns.
And what would that do to...
Theoretically, it wouldn't do anything, because you're just subtracting by a constant. So constant is a...
So would it just be shifted?
It just shifted. Yeah, my capital allocation would just steep because of it. Okay. But it still looks good. Okay, it still makes sense. Okay. So here's the other thing. So here's the step one, which is going to be the minimum variance portfolio calculation. I'll walk you through. The second step is going to do these iterations in the solver. The third step in the solver is going to be the capital allocation calculation. Okay. To trace out the efficient frontier, what we need to do is to put the highest return portfolio in here, but it already does it for you. Because what I did was I set up a procedure to go up to the returns up there and put the maximum in. So the maximum here is going to go right there automatically. So it's already programmed. And I got the minimum right here. This minus this divided by 15 is going to give me my iteration differential on the expected returns. It sets it up for you. Already done. Okay. So don't overstep stuff. If you're not you know, sure of something, then ask me so you don't screw it up, right? Because it's already programmed. All right. So once that's done, then what we can do is we can do the minimum variance portfolio. And what's going to happen is all of your portfolio allocations are going to be printed in here. Okay? And run it, copy it, paste it over here as a value. You're going to run it, copy and paste it over here. You're going to run it, copy and paste it over here to do the integration. So there's procedures you've got to go through. So let me walk you through the first iteration to get the minimum variance portfolio. You want to go up to solver, and it's going to give you the solver. Now, what I already did is not only do you have
62
down here pictures of the solver pages for step one, step two, step three. It's already there. And I've also included a big picture of it right here in this sheet right here. So if you're not certain what the solver should be, that's all you got to do is click on this and replicate it over here and go back to the optimization page and run it. So this needs to be here. Needs to be a dollar sign, chef, dollar sign, 63. This one is already set. This one's already set. Excellent. So now I can go back to the optimization page.
What'd you set that to? What'd you set it to?
So the first step to calculate the minimum variance portfolio, this has got to be F63. So what I did is I went back, put in dollar sign F63. It's got to be minimum. Click on minimum. Got it. And that procedure right there, that applies. So this thing's ready to go. Okay? So is everybody clear where we are right now? We're calculating the first step, minimum variance portfolio.
Can you show where F63 is?
Yeah.
Where is it?
Yep. And just make sure that when you move around the page, it doesn't mess up any of the F63
is one of our spots.
Right here. So we're minimizing the standard deviation of the because we're calculating the minimum variance.
So we'll just copy that.
Go back to solver. It should be minimized at 63. What you're doing, the changing variables is going to be the weights right here. And your constraint is to set all of these weights to 1 or 100. Does that make sense? Because all of these right here. All of these weights right here have to add up to 100. And once you run it, it's going to input the weights here, and then it's going to put the weights in here. Okay. So are we ready to go?
Okay.
So if you run the solver, it's running, blah, 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 blah. Dun, 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 dun. It's a pretty heavy-duty procedure. In the 80s when we used to run this stuff, and Ibbotson would probably take like 2 hours to run. Now it takes like 20 seconds. Okay. You click on OK, and as you can see, it totally matches. So then I basically grab this, right-click it, copy it, I'm going to bring this over here, right-click it, and I'm going to click the 1, 2, 3, right there. That's the one I'm going to use. And boom, it brings over the values. Okay. Now we did the minimum variance portfolio. Now we got to do the iterations. Okay. Now we're going to do 15 of these things. Okay. So then what we're going to do is we're going to go back here. I want to check my numbers. So I'm going to go to step two. This one is where we're going to. All the settings are the same, except these two. So it's gonna be F63. So I'm gonna go over here. I just wanna make sure it's right. F63. This is all the same, but we gotta add one more procedure. Okay, we gotta add one more constraint. Okay, before we can get started. So the constraint is right here. So we wanna add constraint. The constraint is that this cell right here, this mean expected return on the portfolio, is gonna be equal to this cell right there. Now we're ready to run the first iteration. But before I do that, I'm gonna say okay. I'm going to close this for a second. And we know that this one right here is the first maximum. The rate of return on the portfolio is 22%. So what we're going to do is we're going to put in, actually this should be linked right there. So you may want to link this. So it's informed, okay? So then what you're gonna do is you're gonna take this right here and copy it, put it there, right click it, and do the 1, 2, 3 value. Boom. And I'll show you the second procedure in a second. So to run the first weighting scheme, you gotta make sure that this needs to be linked to this. You copy and paste that as a value there. And then you run the solve. Now you go to solve. We want to minimize.
And then 22% is just your highest mean?
It's the highest expected return.
Okay, and are we manually putting that in, or is it?
No, I just formatted it. So what I would do is go here, click the equal sign, and go to here and input it. So you're not hard coding it, so it doesn't automatically. And then what it'll do is it'll take the maximum minus the minimum divided by 15 will get the iteration differential. It'll take the maximum and then trace out the returns for the efficient frontier. Okay. So it's automated. All right. So now we've set up. And if you ever get confused and go, what are the settings supposed to be? I just go right to the solver page and just double check it to make sure it's correct. Go back to the optimization page, get rid of that right there. It should be F63. Okay. This one. And then I would click solve. Then watch, this will change from 9.9 to 22. It'll kick out the first. Boom, you got the first one. Okay. So then what you want to do, click OK. Go down here, copy this from here. Don't capture this, because it's a set holder. Capture everything underneath it. All of this. Right there. So you're going to capture this right here. Actually, you can do the whole thing. So capture this right here. There. Right click it. And bring it over here. And paste 1, 2, 3. Oh, you're done. So you did the first iteration. Now you need to do the second iteration. So go here to F80, right click it, copy it, and move it right here, right click it, and paste 1, 2, 3. Got it. Okay. Then go to solver. It's all set up, ready to go. Click OK, click solve. Now it's running the weighting scheme for the 20.7%. It's going to kick in right here.
Because he has it up to 10.5.
It's going to kick in. It's still running.
He has it up to 10.5.
There it goes. So it just did the 20.7% scenario. So now what you do, you go over there, click OK. You go over here, you get that one right there, because you don't want to mess up the formula. Copy it, go right here, right click it, and go paste 1, 2, 3, boom. And then do that procedure for all 15 of the iterations. Okay. Once you do that, everything's pretty much done, and you can go down, because I have it all set up, that the capital allocation line will basically calculate itself. Okay. And then you go down, and this is how mine works.
And which one of those is a graphing?
This is graphing.
Which iteration?
This is graphing all 15. These are all 15 iterations. This is the expected return. This is the standard deviation. And then the capital allocation is right there. And then the capital allocation line is gonna probably stop right here. But then I'll show you how to anchor it to the y-axis so it looks like this. So can you guys do that?
Pajamas.